Hello everybody, I'm Eugene, and today we are going to talk about concurrency. And I want to start with the very small experiment here. On count three, please raise your left and right hand concurrently. One, two, three. Cool. Now I know that A, everybody knows what is concurrently, and B, that you are able to raise your hands. And we have a lot to talk about, and don't worry, at least I have a good excuse. I will blame any delays on the lightning talks. All right, next question to raise your hands. Who is doing Rails? Wow. Is it Rails conference or Ruby conference? Interesting. All right, next raising hands question. Please raise your hand if you agree that you shouldn't worry about concurrency if you are using Rails. Cool. Oh, one. Yes. If your application is single-threaded. Nobody. If you have a very low traffic application. One. All right, raise your hands if you are taking active measures to prevent concurrency issues in your applications. One, two, three, four, five, six. Cool. For those who didn't raise hands on the last question, that's what can happen. This is, for those who don't recognize, this is Seattle monorail. So as this is monorail, you can see it as the single-threaded Rails application. And it's pretty low traffic because Seattle was fine with these two processes for a long, long time until this happened. Now we are using only one process. So when the concurrency issues have a chance to arrive? Not when you are developing applications, because when you are starting your development, you are sitting in a tiny and very comfortable sandbox. You have at most one process of Rails and at most one database. And by the way, in this talk, I am assuming that you are using traditional stack with relational databases. And if you are using non-relational databases, you have your own set of concurrency issues. As soon as we are going to production, we have a chance to encounter the first side of the concurrency issues. We have multiple processes talking to the same database. And as soon as you are starting to scale your application for more traffic, you are getting the second aspect. This is related to unpredictable request routing. You never can tell which host will answer the next request or even in what order this request will be answered. Okay, we'll start with the Rails-specific issues of concurrency, and if time allows, we'll cover some non-Rails issues at the end. Before we start, we want to establish some toolbox that will help us to test for concurrency issues, and we don't need to do a lot. First, we want to point our test environment to a real database, and apologies to somebody who thinks that SQLite is a real database. And we need a tiny helper method available to all your tests that does very simple thing. It takes the block that it's given and forks several processes that will exercise this code. This will simulate the multi-process environment. And at the end, we are just making sure that all the processes successfully exit. Very simple. I'm cheating a little. In reality, it should be a little bit more involved because as we are dealing with concurrency, we should be concurrency safe ourselves. So we need to make sure that each process has its own database connection. And also I'm taking care of the second shared resource, IO. And the only thing that I'm doing is abbreviating exception messages for the simple reason. If you have 20 processes outputting backtrace, interleaved, good luck with trying to find what was the error. All right, and let's look at the first facet, the simplest one. This is how you can guarantee that records in your database, in your table, are unique by some value. And Rails provide a very couple means to do this. And the first mean is first to create, or it's now deprecated, twin brother find to create by. To test this, we'll create a simple model called number, very sophisticated name. It has one attribute conveniently called value. And we'll do a very simple test. We'll ask our processes to create a record corresponding to the current size of the table. And really, the key issue when you are testing for concurrency is try to guarantee that your processes collide as much as possible. And here, the size of the table is just used for as a simple synchronization mechanism. And at the end, we are comparing number of unique values in our table and number of records. So we run our test, and we are getting 50 non-unique records out of 99 that we managed to create. What's going on inside? We'll use the very convenient inspection tool that Rails provides. You'll probably use it. It's called Rails Console. We'll do our statement and see what statements active record outputs in the log. And we can see that first to create does exactly what it promises. It checks if record exists. If it doesn't exist, it creates a new record. Second process comes in, checks, record already exists, we don't need to do anything. But these processes in concurrent environment can come in slightly different order. And here, first process, check, second process, check, first process, I need to create, and second process also need to create. And we are getting our nice problem. Second method that Rails provides is the uniqueness validation on the model level. And to test this, there is another model that enforces this validation. And practically the same test with slightly corrected syntax for new stuff. And practically the same result. And if we look at the active record log, we see that we have, again, practically the same behavior. The only difference is that select statement has a slightly different form and it's moved inside the transaction. And we get our problem. How to fix this? Pretty easy. We already know the entity that knows about all the processes that we are running, and this entity is database. We need to ask database to make sure that the records are unique. And the easiest way for this is to create a unique index on the field that we are interested in. Here we are. But unfortunately, this is not enough. If we just do this change to existing table on existing application, we are getting a bunch of errors for any concurrency clash. And this is record not unique exception. So we need to spend some time and modify our application code to straighten things up. This is also pretty easy. We just need, first, we should stop using uniqueness validation because there is no safe way to save us from its failures. And for first to create, we need to wrap it to custom function. In this particular case, you can wrap it different ways, but this is the simplest way. You just catch the exception and retry. It will for sure succeed on the second time. And we run our tests. Success. Cheating again. Success is achieved on Postgres. If you run MySQL, you have a chance to get yet another exception that has a couple not good surprises. So first one is that it's maybe not good, but just really surprise how MySQL manages to get a deadlock on performing exactly the same operation. And second is that it's mapped to a very generic statement invalid exception. So to fix this for MySQL, we need to add one more catch block in our method that unfortunately has to dig inside the message guts and check is this really our exceptional case or not. And good luck to us all for MySQL and MySQL adapter changing the messaging in the future. We run our tests, and now we are succeeding on all the databases. Go. Facet number two. Here we are talking about issues associated with associations or related to relations. And this is very similar facet. To test this, we will use very, very practical example. We'll try to construct a dog. So we have a class dog that has one head and many legs. Unfortunately, Rails doesn't have has for relation, otherwise I would use it. And we'll have corresponding classes for heads and legs. And here's our simple test. We'll bootstrap 20 headless and legless dogs, sorry. And then we'll try to concurrently fix the problems in our processes. We'll backfill our heads and backfill our legs. To test the result, we'll just use a custom function that I'm not showing here that converts the table state to human readable string and compare it with the expected result of 20 dogs having one head and four legs each. All right, we'll run our test, and three dogs with one head and eight legs, two dogs with two heads and 28 legs, two dogs with one head and 12 legs. Here it is. You can see we have one dog with one head and four legs. Unfortunately, I couldn't find the picture that would illustrate this well. All right, what's going on with heads? Let's look inside, and here we can see not one, but four different problems. First of all, create head creates a head already attached to a dog. This means that if this dog happened to have a head before, we are guaranteed to have two heads at least for a while. Next, this is the common problem for most active record-related concurrency issues. We have select before update. And what Active Record is doing here, it selects a record from the database in attempt to get the previous head if it existed, then compares to one that was just created. And if it's the same, does nothing. If they are different, it cuts the old head. But what is old? Next problem, Rails assumes that this dog had at most one head before. Maybe valid assumption in the single-threaded environment. And another problem is what is missing in this statement. This statement doesn't have any explicit order. And no database guarantees you the order of the records that would be returned if you don't provide the explicit one. In the matter of fact, for practical reason, I can guarantee you that Postgres and MySQL will return your records in different order. So Rails' assumption that this statement will return the previous head is kind of optimistic. And we're getting something like this. What's going on with legs? This case situation is a little bit better because in this case, Rails doesn't do any assumption of how many legs were before, and it doesn't attach anything before detaching. It's done in proper order, but we still have the same common problem of select before update that obviously can interleave with different processes. And we're getting this. So how to fix the head problem? Okay, I'm not talking about general head problems, so this particular head problem. Obvious way is to fix the same way as we fixed uniqueness, because the foreign key on this table can be constrained by uniqueness. But we are trying to look for the better and more common solution for all the relations. So we'll still ask the database, but we'll ask database different way from the application layer. And here we just move our creation inside the transaction, and we are locking the dog record. Keep in mind here that we are locking the record that we are not going to modify at all. This locking is just used for synchronizing synchronization between our processes. And if you run our tests, hooray, everything is fine. Again, you probably should expect that if as I had left enough space, I am cheating again. This time we are fine on MySQL, but not on Postgres. What we can see here that we fixed the legs problem. All our dogs have 4 legs, but we still have many heads. How to really fix this the way that it would work for Postgres? Let's see what's crashing our effort. The problem we have is between these two problems in our log. One is attachment the new head up front and unordered select statement below. Meaning that if there was a head attached by, before this action by a different process, if this happens on in a very short period of time, Postgres can return these records in different order. But we have easy way to fix this by removing only one variable from this equation. We can just create a head separately, not attached to a dog, and do attachment later. In this case, we should be fine for all the issues, and let's modify our code, run tests, fine. Another way to do this, sometimes you want to avoid the database locks, especially if your application is high traffic, and you remember that we didn't modify dog records, and we may want to allow other processes to modify these records while we are attaching heads and legs. And for this, there is another simple approach. We just need to do cleanup ourselves after. What I'm doing here, after creating a head or adding a leg, or 4 legs, there is a separate statement that cleans up everything that is not necessary that may be remaining from other processes. And in this case, at least one process is guaranteed to be the last who will perform the final cleanup. Key part to pay attention here is that all the processes have to agree what to keep and what to drop. And they shouldn't be greedy trying to preserve what they just attached. We are running the tests and everything is fine. Whew. Facet number 3, immigration. How do we do our database migrations while our service is running in production? We can easily add tables. We can add columns or add indices. Maybe we'll get some potentially big performance hits by doing this, but still our application is running fine. But if we try to remove columns from our tables, even if now our application doesn't use any of these fields, we can have bad problems, at least before Rails 4 that fixed this. I'm not sure how well it did, but at least it was a well-guided, conscious attempt to fix the problem. If we try to remove the column while we are running in production, our production hosts will start to get exceptions, statement invalid, because Active Records still relies on this field to be present in the database, and thus it provides these queries directly to the MySQL or to Postgres, and they complain. And the worst part with this is that this would not crash your application. It's kind of a paradox that not crashing your application is a bad in this case. It means that your application is successfully running and you're just crashing all the requests that are touching this table. Okay, how, so what's going on? In this case, we need to look at the Rails source code, and we can see that Active Record minimizes the columns of your tables at startup time and never ever modifies this list. Good thing about this is that it also gives us the means to fix the problem, because all the operations are using this method directly or indirectly, and this is true for almost all Rails versions. Notice the gap here. Rails 3.1 went super creative with memoization. How do we fix this? Simple. We need to add to our model that we are trying, where we're trying to get rid of the field, the overriding of the columns method, that will just hide this column from active record. After we deploy our application, and more important, the base level of active record has no clue about the fact that this column exists. After that, we can easily remove the column and without any crashes, and we can do the cleanup any time later. All right, here is the procedure for 3.1. I got this answer on Stack Overflow. No, I need to read this. Skip step 1 and 2 that are common for everything. 3, start up a new database that is master to your existing database. Stop replication from your new database. Drop your columns on the new database server. One at a time, reconfigure each application server to use the new database server and restart. Turn replication back on for your new database. Once the original server has caught back up, reconfigure the application to use that database server again with applicable restarts. Stop replication and turn off the new database server. If I turn off this slide, can you please recite the steps by memory? All right. Number 4, related to asset pipeline. Very nice invention, and I really appreciate Rails core team for doing this. To see what can happen with the asset pipeline, we need to look at how do we do our deployments in production. One way to do it is to shut down your application and restart it on all your hosts. Absolutely no concurrency or asset pipeline issues, only one minor problem: you took down your website for unpredictable time. I don't know, maybe this is not a problem for somebody, but if you're trying to strive for now fashionable term zero downtime, you may want to do it slightly differently. And this way, you are pushing the new code to one single host, then you are swapping the server to look at the new code, pushing to the new next server. And so what's the problem here? At this stage, this write server is still serving red pages. And the code that lies underneath has only green stuff. And asset pipeline during precompilation did a very nice, good job of cleaning up all the old stuff and putting only new stuff on your local public folder. And this means that all the red pages requests for assets coming to this host will be denied with 404. Maybe not what you are looking for, again, if you're looking for zero downtime. And you can try alternative to this mix of two approaches. You can shut down on a single host, launch a new one, and here again, we have a problem. The problem is with the unpredictable routing, because you never know which host will receive the request for assets. And in this case, for red pages, requests can come to the green host, and from green pages, requests can come to the red host. So in this particular state, exactly half of your pages don't have any CSS or JavaScript. How to fix this? Again, Rails did a good job, and they have all bits and pieces to fix this. Unfortunately, we need just to assemble them together. And main part here is stop serving your assets locally. Push them to asset hosts and use the asset host configuration. If you're using S3 as your asset host, you can use the gem asset sync, and that will just plug into your asset pipeline, and after compiling the assets, it will upload to S3. Or it's not a rocket science to roll out your own solution. to upload your assets before the deployment. And again, important part, before even you try to start your deployment. Next, don't repeat the mistake the asset pipeline does. Don't clean up old stuff too early. And make sure that you are not overriding your assets, that new ones are stored in the different files. Whew. How are we on time? Good. So we are wrapping our Rails part. We are going to maybe more interesting, not only Rails part. And facet here is for how do we combine our continuous development of the application with also continuous deployments of new features and changed features. And this statement is almost 3 decades old and was not related to the software because it was ex-Secretary of Defense. And now you can say that combining them is not counterproductive, it's just hard. And if we like, look at this already familiar picture, I can explain what's going on, but better if somebody can help me. 4 volunteers, come in. 3 more. Guys, don't be shy. Go, 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 go. Okay, who wants to be a server and who wants to be a client? Server. Servers. I need 2 servers. 1 stand under red one and then 1 under green one. And clients, please move to the different sides of the screen for me to easily distinguish you. So you will be server number 1, old one. You will be server number 2, new, improved one. You are client number 1, you are client number 2. All right, for our servers, let's start with the old one. You are a lollipop serving server. And you have a very simple API. When client asks you, where is my lollipop? You will say, I have your lollipop in my left pocket. Please put it in your left pocket. Your left. Okay, and let's start with the client. I forgot. The next request, obvious request from the client is, please give me your lollipop from your left pocket. All right, Mr. Client number 1. By the way, I will be routing all the requests.
Please give me your lollipop from your left pocket.
Nope. No? I'm also controlling a router. Okay. Your first question is, where is my lollipop?
Where is my lollipop?
Where is his lollipop?
It's in my left.
It's in his left pocket. Stop. Don't ask your second question because, you are going to go to Twitter or Facebook.
Sure.
You want to spend some time. And we have the new improved version that we are trying to launch that has the lollipop in the right pocket. And this is the whole improvement. All right, client number 2, please ask your first question. No, I'm router.
Okay. Router, okay.
Where is my lollipop?
Where is my lollipop?
Okay, where is his lollipop?
Lollipop is in my right pocket.
Lollipop is in his right pocket. Okay, second question. Please give me your lollipop.
Yes. Please give me your lollipop out of your right pocket.
Please give him his lollipop out of his right pocket. I want you to perform, if you can, just show us how the page not found should look like. All right, client number 1, you wake up. You return from Twitter. Ask your question.
Where's my lollipop?
No, you already asked this. You already know that the lollipop is in the left pocket.
Give me the lollipop from the left pocket.
Okay, give him his lollipop from his left pocket.
Eh?
No. Your improved version of the server.
Improved.
You should crash on this. All right. So, how to fix this problem? And the fix is really easy. Just a little bit elaborate. What we need to do is, dear old server, can you please put this in your right pocket too?
Yeah.
new server to the left pocket. Now we can successfully swap the servers, and we are not damaged of the concurrent existence for our clients. So clients, I'm going to reroute your...
Should I shift refresh? Where is my lollipop?
Refresh. you still remember where is the lollipop? Yeah.
Can you give me my lollipop from the left pocket?
Okay, can you give him his lollipop from the left pocket? Here is your lollipop. And yours?
Can you give me my lollipop from the right pocket, please?
From the right pocket, please. All right. Everything is fine. We have clients satisfied with lollipops, and I think that we have servers that are still having one lollipop for themselves. Thank you, guys. So one of the things that you need to make sure that you need to wait some time after you swap your servers, not dogs. Couple of minutes. After we made sure that this client that went to tweet, to Facebook, or for a weekly vacation already successfully forgot where the lollipop is, you can clean up your code from the new server. Key, again, here is to remember that your website is an API provider. And you probably can't imagine any API provider like Twitter just swapping the new version of the API for the swapping the old to the new one without giving sufficient grace period to all your clients. Okay, almost there. Repeating my original question, here is my answer, where you shouldn't worry about your concurrency. And by the way, it's not necessarily negative. Yes, it can be arrogance or ignorance, or this may be calculated risk for your application. But if you care about concurrency, you should just remember all this, basically two main aspects, shared resources and unpredictable routing. And you will find your way, one way or another. And another thing, when you are using this delicious dish served by Rails, please don't forget about fine print. All right, final, wrap up. This is for homework. If you ace this facet, then you will ace all the concurrency issues. I will ask you to design the application that will help me or somebody else to prepare such presentation. And requirements are that I can insert a slide at any position. I can easily shuffle all the slides in my application. And I shouldn't care about explicit saves. Everything happens behind the scenes. And bonus points to everybody who consider, first, synchronous versus asynchronous messaging. Second, what would happen if some of these messages are just lost? They disappeared in space. Next, what would happen if these messages come out of order? And this is quite possible, especially with asynchronous messaging. And one more tricky part. What would happen to the user application and the state of this presentation if I try to save a new slide or reorder from the tab or from the browser that is week old, or even an hour old, and I worked on this application from different browser in the meantime? Extra bonus, it's like dozen bonuses. If your design would allow also to extend this application to have the collaborative editing by multiple users. And when you finish this, please talk to me. I will give you my business card. You will know where to send your resume. All right, this is just necessary part that I had to put here. And we are at QA. And I hope that we'll have no time for QA. All right, at least I have an excuse. You heard my accent. I have an excuse to pretend not understanding your questions.
Of course we have time for questions.
All right.
Or maybe one question.
Maybe two, maybe three. Anybody? As one of my teachers told, if audience have no questions, there are two possibilities. Everybody understood everything, or nobody understood anything.
Thank you.